Welcome to a bonus edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. Yes, I've snuck in a bonus episode once again when I said the last interview was the last one. I am joined by former WWF light heavyweight champion, former WWF tag team champion, former WWE tag team champion, one of my favorite wrestlers in the world, Bushir birthday, which I've mentioned to him every time I've met him or messaged him on Twitter. I am joined by Scott Garland, aka Scotty 2 Hotty. Welcome to the show.
Thanks, man. Thanks for finally making this work. I know we've been going back and forth for probably a year and a half now.
Probably. You know,
since I got back out on the independent scene. And so I appreciate it. Finally, you being able to make it work, man. And it sounds so weird to hear you say WWF now. Like, for the longest time, you know, WWE sounded weird. And now when we say WWF, it's like, it's weird. It's hard for me to talk about that time frame and call it WWE, though. And I think it is for a lot of people. You know, we grew up on WWF. It wasn't WWE, right?
Exactly, yeah. The only time you hear WWF now is people that watched it back then and don't watch it now, and they talk about going, oh, do you remember The Rock and the WWF?
Yeah,
I do. It's E now, yeah. Though. So, right, you know. Right. But there was that weird two-week period where it was WWFE, and that was
Yeah, that's right. I forgot about that. Yeah.
That was a horrible time for trying to write things or trying to remember. But yeah, usually in these podcasts, I'll delve right to the start of your story and then we'll pick and choose. But you have such a long and varied career. I'm just going to just pick and choose bits and pieces as we go and see where it ravels from there, if you don't mind.
And yeah, sounds good, man.
Because I'm sure you've already told many podcasters and interviewees and interviewers how you got started in wrestling. So I'm sure if people really want to know, they'll find it themselves.
Yeah.
So as a Scottish Wrestling Network, as a Scottish Wrestling Podcast, of course, we are going to talk about you coming over to Scotland. And my first kind of note of one through the wonderful website Cage Match was 2004. So was that right about the first time you came over to Scotland, or did you have any trips beforehand with any other
2004 people? Was with WWE. Right? That's – where was that?
Well, I've got noted Aberdeen.
It was in Aberdeen.
AACC. You were teaming with Rikishi against Hoss and Benjamin.
Yeah, I remember it, but it's dude, it's so weird. That's what I keep saying, like, about the difference between doing these trips with WWE and the way that I do them now. And I know the crew's over there right now in England, and it's Belfast, Dublin, Paris, London, you know, Aberdeen, like Glasgow, and you're just bouncing and you're flying every day pretty much. And it's a whirlwind that you don't really get to appreciate it. Whereas now I try to structure these tours where I can actually see something and try to, you know, hang out in the towns a little bit and take it all in, you know.
Yeah, so was that it? Pretty much you came into Aberdeen as the example. You came into Aberdeen, saw the venue, and AACC was out with anything. I think there was a hotel across the road from it and maybe a McDonald's close by. It's not in the town at all, so it's not like you got to have a little explore in between and what have you. But yeah, so was that it during the WWE tours? It was just in and out and hope you
see something. A lot of times that's what it is, and you're so tired on those tours that you know you either I'm going to sleep, try to get some sleep in the hotel, or I'm going to go to the gym and try to get a workout in, and you don't really get to do a whole lot, you know. And honestly, man, like, that's why I'm having so much fun now, is just being able to play tourist a little bit, see some stuff, and you know, meet some people and work out at the different gyms for a few days in a row sometimes, you know, so it's really cool.
So, and from my note again, it's 10 years after that was last, it was the next time you'd come to Aberdeen, because that's when I first met you, was 2014 for WrestleZone.
Right, so I remember that, you know, and that's where I wrestled Grado.
It was. And,
I think X-Pac was there, and but again, you know, at that time, I did things a little bit differently, where it's kind of, I wanted to get in and out as fast as I could and be home. My kids were smaller, you know. Now they're 18 and 21, so they're adults, and you know, I don't feel like I'm missing out on some of the school stuff and the sports stuff, and you know, all that extra stuff, like I would have then, you know. So I will. I, like as just for an example, you know, my first show next week is in Crowley, just south of London. And I'm leaving here on Monday and I get to London on Tuesday. So I'll have Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday before I even start my tour. So I get to, you know, again, play tourist around London a little bit and relax and enjoy it before I start off, you know.
It's one of those things I've only really started to learn to appreciate that when you're saying that you're now just at the time, sorry, in 2014, you were just kind of in and out and you structured it differently. Now that I've got a 1 year old who turns one in 2 weeks. So I've learned to kind of, when I'm doing this podcast, I've done this podcast for 3 years. So this last year has been really, I'll get someone if I can get someone on, but I'm not I'm not rushing now because I want to spend as much time as I can with my son. Yeah. So it's just one of those weird things where I'd never really appreciate it until that happened. It's like, you know what? Podcasting isn't as important. And for you, you probably went, wrestling's fine. Wrestling's paying the bills, but you know, I'd rather be a dad most of the time.
Yeah. No, I agree, man.
But speaking of that match with Grado, I've heard a lot of things around about it. Marty Jones was at the show, and he wasn't happy that you shaved your head, particularly on that particular night. Because of course, everyone will have known Scott Hotty with the big hair, the bucket hats, and what have you. And you came out with the, I mean, I'm sporting the same haircut right now. So when you went back on the independent scene in the first place, was that kind of just a like kind of cleansing of yourself a little bit there when you did that, or was it just a case of I fancy just being bald for a bit?
No, I mean, if that was 2014, I had been out 2014, you said, right? No, I mean, I had left WWE in 2007, so I had been out for a while. I changed my hair all the time, and I just I've shaved it a few times. It's been dark. It's been blonde. I've had a mullet over the years. I've done a bunch of different things. I didn't realize it was going to upset Marty Jones so much, I guess. I didn't even know that till just you told me, but it was just something I did for a short period and then that's it, you know?
So then that point would have been 7 years. So when you said your tours were structured a little bit differently, but was it more of a chance you got to see more fans? Because in a WWE tour, it would have been maybe getting to see people around the barrier after the show. So did you find out more at that point how much people appreciated you as a person when you got to meet them face-to-face? Or was there a huge difference after being the WWE tour lifestyle and being that first period of Scotty Hotty doing tours?
Yeah, but it was then, Billy, but not as much as now. This run right here that I've been on since leaving WWE at the end of 21, and you know, starting back up in January 22 and coming back, it's multiplied like 100 times. It's been so cool, and I think part of it is, you know, Too Cool and Rikishi happened in the year 2000, right? So if there was a kid who was 10 years old in 2000. You're looking at, you know, they're in their 30s, you know, in their 30s now. So it's like, you know, not only for them, for me and for them, I think was like, I was done wrestling, you know? So to have that opportunity to go back out and, you know, perform in front of them and for me to meet them and them to meet me, I think it's a cool thing that I don't know if either one of us ever thought was going to happen again. You know, it's just been, it's been overwhelmingly, I keep saying overwhelmingly emotional at times. Just, dude, I've literally had grown men like break down in front of me, and it causes me to do the same, you know? And it's like, I didn't expect that when I came back out. It's just, and I understand it. It's like, you know, that time, 2000, that whole Attitude Era, it was so popular and there's so many people watching it. That I don't think we realized until, you know, the effects that we would have to all these years later, you know, and especially I think then you throw in, not only was it so popular, but we've lost so many of those people, you know, and they're not around. So when you do get to meet somebody, I think from that time period, it's pretty cool, you know, for me and for them, you know, and that's why I'm like, just appreciating this run so much, and it's been so like just so fun, man.
I'm one of those 30-year-olds because 2010 in the UK especially, the first kind of real wrestling we, well, real WWF wrestling we got to see was on Channel 4. It was terrestrial television. It was free TV. And it was, they had a couple of pay-per-views. We got Royal Rumble 2000.
That's what everybody's been telling me. I didn't know that until, you know, over the last year or so. And so that's really cool to hear.
Yeah, so the first memory a lot of people my age will have will be the dance breakdown during the Royal Rumble match itself. Some people go back and say, oh, 2000 wasn't a great Rumble. It was quite obvious who was going to win, but I don't care. It was my first Rumble that I got to see live, and that nostalgia always carries through anything you ever think of.
Dude, wrestling's about moments. You know, if you can create moments, that's what people remember. You can have all the flips and all the dives and all the moves and all the wins, the losses. Like people remember moments, you know, and I believe that's true for all forms of entertainment, not only wrestling. You know, if you can create cool moments where you can make people actually feel something inside, like that's the trick to what we do, you know, and to connect with that audience and give them that memory in the moment, you know.
That's it. I mean, I try to write reviews after I go to shows, and I realize that eventually it just comes down to me. I remember this bit. I don't remember the hammerlocks or the headlocks or anything like that, but I remember this emotional moment where something happened, and that's the bit that made me feel feelings, I suppose, put it. And it's fine. It's weird, like, we've seen the discourse online now of people breaking down matches, and my thought now as a 30, well, almost 33-year-old man is watching it going, but did you feel it? Did you feel something from it? Did you watch? I'm going to watch Money in the Bank on Saturday, tonight as of release, and I know that I'm going to feel something watching that show. And it's not going to be whatever stars you want to put to it, but as long as you felt emotion during it, that's the most important thing for wrestling.
Right.
That's my own discourse. You mentioned Magic Kingdom, and I've followed you on Instagram for a little bit, and I know you love your Disneyland and your theme parks.
Is
there plans in your UK tour upcoming? You've got a couple shows in France. Is Disneyland Paris on the itinerary?
How'd you know? Actually, I'm bringing my girlfriend over, and we're like I said, we'll get to London on Tuesday. Spend some time there. Do the show in Crowley on Friday night. I have a seminar and a show on Friday night for Kaboom. Or Kapow. And then we'll fly to South France on Saturday morning, and then do a show there Saturday night. And then Sunday we'll take the train up to Disneyland Paris and spend, I think, four days up there. And I don't think all 4 days will be at Disneyland, but two or three probably, and then go into the city for a day. So. Yeah, absolutely, man. Disneyland Paris is probably my favorite park if I had to pick one. And I've been to all of them except for the two China parks, Hong Kong and Shanghai. I've never been there, but I've done Disneyland in California, of course. Here I live in Orlando, so you know we do this one all the time. And then Tokyo Disneyland, been there two or three times when I was wrestling over there. But Disneyland Paris just has something special about it. It's really, really cool.
I went there for my honeymoon. That was such a cool time. What is it about going to Disneyland, though? Is it the same kind of thing when we were speaking about wrestling? It's about moments. Is it about those moments you capture going to those theme parks and with your children?
I think it's about moments, but I think it's also an escapism, you know, where you can kind of forget about, especially when you're on holiday, right? You can kind of forget about all the real world and the bills and going to work and all the you know, the real life stuff. And, you know, and you can kind of escape, which is, you know, you're supposed to do with pro wrestling too. You know, it's kind of an escapism. That's what I say for, you know, when I do my seminars, you know, these people come for two and a half hours, 3 hours. And our job is to make them forget the real world for that time that they're there. That's what they're paying us for, you know. And like, how do you make them forget about the cable bill that's 2 months late, or, you know, the negativity going on social media, or COVID and all the problems that came out of COVID? Like, how do you make them forget that? That's my job. I could care less about any star rating from any 40-year-old guy writing a report on my match. You know what I mean? Like, my job is to, you know, make those people feel something, give them a good night. And, you know, they spend money that they work hard for to come and pay to pay to see us. So like, how do I give them that same thing? So yeah, I think it's the same thing. It's just the escapism. And it's cool. And, you go and everybody's having a good time, you know? So I guess, makes you feel good. And there's, then there's the, just the creative aspect of some of the rides and how well done they are. And I don't know, I can't explain it. There's a saying in wrestling where they say, maybe you've heard it before, for those who get it, no explanation is necessary. For those who don't, no explanation will do. And it kind of applies to wrestling and Disney. Like there's people, that hate Disney or hate the theme parks. And like, I don't understand how you can do that. Or same thing with wrestling. Why do you watch that fake stuff? Blah, blah, blah. It's that saying kind of says it all. Like if they get it, they get it. If they don't, they're never going to get it. And that's okay. You know, it's not for them, but.
Yeah. Absolutely. I'm actually so excited to go back to the Paris one because since I've been from IG 2018, so since then they've had the big Avengers areas being put up and all that kind of stuff, the World of Marvel or wherever it's called. I'm like,
yeah,
I need to find an excuse to, I need my boy to kind of just grow up a little bit quicker. Not too quick. Yeah. I still wouldn't miss anything, but at the same time, get old enough so we can go.
Yeah. We started taking my daughter. My daughter was 8. We didn't live here at the time. My daughter was 8 weeks old the first time I brought her to Disney World. And that was one of the things I said when we had her. It was like, okay, we've traveled and we've gone to all these theme parks and stuff. And I didn't want to change any of that. You know, I want to live just like we lived. And like, you know, so we brought her and it's great. You know, I have home movies now when she's a baby and of her being at Magic Kingdom. And, you know, now she's going to auditions and she's working at Universal Studios. She's a performer at Universal and she's trying to get in with Disney. And, you know, so it's really cool. I came across a video recently of her dancing as a performer. I don't know if you saw it. She's dancing in the Mardi Gras parade at Universal Studios as a performer. And I found a home movie of her dancing in the same exact spot when she was like 2 years old. So, and I put the two together and it's so cool, man. So cool.
That's amazing. I mean, I like that for me, wrestling is my escapism, but for wrestlers, it is these kind of like things that are as far away from wrestling as they can be is the theme parks and what have you, which I mean, I think McFoley is quite famous for it as well.
A lot of people, it's a lot of people that sports, you know, there's a lot of people that are into, football or you know, basketball, baseball, and they just consume all that and they're in it and they could tell you everything about every player. And I can't, sports have never been my thing, but it's kind of music and theme parks and wrestling is my life, you know?
It's a nice life to.
I always say everybody's a nerd for something, Absolutely. Everybody's a nerd for something. I'm a nerd for wrestling and theme parks. So
That's a great combo. I will lie to you. Mine's wrestling and Marvel films. That's my two kind of points.
Dude, hold on. I got to show you if you like Marvel. Hold on. Let me grab it.
So excited.
So my buddy has a warehouse in Atlanta. I'm probably not even supposed to show you this. I can't remember what he told me when he gave it to me. But I got this bottle that was in... I think one of the Avengers movies, he said. I need to go through and watch it and try to see if I can find it. But he's got this warehouse in Atlanta where, cause they shoot a lot of stuff there now, they do like Stranger Things and Walking Dead and all kinds of different movies they shoot there. So he's got just I think there were 3 or 4 giant warehouses where he just stores props and these movie companies will come in and they'll rent all these different props from him, and like he had that and he gave it to me when I was up there. So that's from one of the Avengers movies.
I'm going to screen cap that and I'm going to watch the Avengers films probably over the next couple of weeks so I can find it. I'll be that guy. Right? That's amazing.
You have to let me know if you find it.
I will scour the Avengers films till I find it. Amazing. That's made my day. So on that tour of the UK, we'll go back to your trip to Scotland in a bit, but I've got something about your UK tour which we're going to plug copiously throughout this next wee while. You mentioned you've got Kapow, you've got your trips to France as well, and then you're back in England 14th, 15th. They have one for Pro Wrestling Live on the 14th, 15th with North in Newcastle. Yeah. it's a fairly star-studded lineup. I was looking at it, it's got Gangrel, Mercedes Martinez, and Joey Janela. My interest about this North one, though, is I think one of the last times you were there, you were against Joe Hendry. And he does one of his entrance videos, which is available on YouTube. I'm just very curious because I don't speak to a lot of people that have been a victim of Joe Hendry's entrance videos. What was the kind of prep? Did you have any prep? Were you just standing there and it happened? What's the kind of setup?
Well, they didn't tell me about it, which is the only thing I wish they had told. Two things. I wish I had known about it because it was awesome. It was awesome. It was creative. And that's what I love. You know, guys who try different stuff and they do different things. And it was amazing. And he did a great job with it. And I think he's a good dude. And he's going to do some awesome things here in the next few years. That being said, from a storytelling standpoint, and that's what we do is tell stories. I was in the ring, didn't know about the video. They played the video. So I had to stand there and watch this thing and then come out and just be like, this guy just made fun of me and buried me in front of everybody. And now I just have to go back to being Scotty Too Hotty, this happy-go-lucky character. Whereas from a storytelling perspective, I should be pretty embarrassed, angry, wanting to fight him at this point. Do you know what I mean? So that was the only thing. Like maybe I overthink some things sometimes, and I'm just very particular about, you know, my work and how it's laid out and what I do, and I want everything to make sense. And that was the only thing. That was my only issue with it. No,
I absolutely get that, because yeah, you're right. You should be, once he gets on the apron, you should be battering him. You should be going to beat him down, because he's just said right. That your whole move's rubbish. You weren't as over as Rikishi. So it's just like one of those things. You should be mad at him. Right. I'm just always curious how they go about it, because I think Joe has said, I have heard past interviews with him, that he organizes them like the night before. So he doesn't actually know what he's going to do until he gets there, kind of thing.
Yeah,
so
he put a ton of work into it. You know, to me, it would have felt better if he went out there first and played the video, you know, whatever. Then I come out, because it's still the same thing. But from a viewer's perspective, I didn't see the video. They don't know if I saw it or not, you know, so it just kind of makes more sense. Whereas I just felt like the stupid, you know, we say, just look like a stupid baby face standing there, watching this whole thing play out, and then I don't do anything about it, you know. But dude, that being said, that group is awesome. You know, they have a great crew there and great promoter and just a great atmosphere, and I'm excited to go back, you know. And I know it's a bigger venue. I think they said this is the biggest show that they've done to date, so it's good for them, man. Good for them.
Yeah, I mean, North seems to be doing a really good job in England. It's I'm obviously primarily focused on this side of the border, so I only hear bits and pieces from England, because I've got that many things I've got to remember in Scotland that England just kind of hits the periphery. But North seems to be doing huge shows and getting great guys in, like yourself and Gangrel, and with that nostalgic factor, which helps as well, because Gangrel was supposed to just show up in Aberdeen years ago and he cancelled couldn't attend last minute, and I was like, God, I would have loved to meet Gangrel. Just again, that's my time period when I started watching.
Yeah, he's a good dude. Cool.
Yeah,
too I met cool. Him in, I met him in 1993 when I was in USWA working for Lawler and Jarrett. He came in when I was there, so we go way back. So it's going to be cool to see him. And then Janela, of course, was my first match back with GCW back on January 1st of last year. So it's cool to see him. And then with Mercedes, I worked with her at NXT, and I haven't seen her since. So it's going to be kind of cool for me too. You know.
Yeah. A little bit of a reunion of different eras of your career. Speaking of NXT then, I was going through just doing my research today. Usually I do all my notes on a little notepad like this little Spider-Man notepad. For yourself, I got the big A4 one out, just to make sure I didn't miss anything that I felt like I had to at least mention to you, or like I say, fanboy over you for a bit. But speaking about NXT and Mercedes Martinez there, one of the things that seemed to be like overflowing was the positivity of your training style and your kind of fatherly kind of style. The likes of Otis, Rhea Ripley, Raquel Rodriguez, just going as now, were very complimentary of your your teaching method. Was that something that you always tried to instill, or was it just coincidence that you're a bit more of a focus on the positives kind of person? How did you kind of go about?
Well, I don't know if everybody you talk to from there would say the same thing about me. You know, I think you create relationships with people that you kind of have a connection with, and so there's certain people you might gravitate to, and you know, you see something in, and then others that maybe you don't, and it's not that you don't like each other or whatever, you just don't have that same connection, you know. But there was certain people that I would definitely, like, I would see something, and so I try to create that relationship with them. And I think that's the most important part of coaching, is just creating a relationship where they trust you and you can critique them and they don't get bothered by it, you know, because you do, you have to, you know, you have to correct or critique or push them, or, you know, see the where they're at that day, especially those guys and girls that are in that building in the performance center. Like, dude, that's a full-time job for them, you know, and they're in there every day in their way. You know, you have somebody like Rhea, who's first of all, she was, I think when she came there, she was younger than my daughter, you know, and I think she was 18 maybe when she signed, 18 or 19. I think she was 16 when she had her tryout. And so you got to think, this young girl moves away from her family, moves out to a different country. And now all of a sudden she's being told all these different things. She's been told seven different things from just seven different coaches, and, you know, her head's spinning sometimes, and, you know, and she's still basically a kid at this point, you know? So I don't know. I clicked with her and I saw something in her, and I thought she was different. Both her and Raquel were bigger than the rest of the girls. And I can remember asking if I could have them in my class, because I hadn't had a lot of women in my class, any women in my class up to that point. And I remember going to Matt Bloom and just said, dude, like, there's something with them. Like, can I have them in my class? Just give me a chance with them. And I see them like almost as if they could be a tag team. And I remember saying this to him, like, they could be a tag team, like, you know, like AOP at the time. You know, we had AOP and just a dominant team. And, you know, so that's why it's so cool. It's funny, I talked to Raquel two nights ago, I think it was, and she had posted a video of her flying over to the UK, and Otis was sitting in front of her on the plane, and it's just like, it's so cool to see, you know, them where they're at now. But and I, you know, I told her the other night, it's so cool to see last week on Raw, her and Rhea had that little exchange backstage where Rhea walked through the curtain and Raquel was cutting the promo, you know, and they had the face-to-face thing. And I was like, so cool to see them doing something together on there, you know?
Yeah. It's like watching your kids kind of grow up.
Kind of, for sure.
To see absolutely them on there.
Yeah.
So I did have a question further with that. So when you're in the UK now, are you able to, you do your seminars, you do the shows, are you able to switch between, if you're on a show, you're in wrestler mode, and you're in seminar, you're in trainer mode? Or even when you're wrestling, do you maybe try and watch some of the matches and maybe see if there's anyone that has a little bit of a something that you can see that's tangible that you can possibly expand on?
Yeah, I always try to watch the matches, not only for you know, hopefully I can. I do have this thing though where I won't usually just go to somebody and go, hey, you should do this. Or, you know, if they come up to me, or if we had, you know, maybe we had a conversation earlier in the day, and I have back to the connection thing. You know, I don't want to just be the former WWE guy coming in and I'm telling this guy who works there every month how to do something. And I don't want to be that guy. So if he asks me or she asks me, I'd love to give feedback. You know, or again, if we had a connection earlier in the day and I feel like I can give them, you know, any type of, you know, advice or constructive criticism, I love it, you know. But I also like to watch it for myself, because if I see, you know, I know I'm going to be on in the fifth match and I see the first four matches, they're going outside and they're fighting around the ring or they're doing something, and I see it over and over, I go, okay, what am I going to do? I have to think, okay, what am I going to do differently when I get out there? You know, I don't, so I watch it for multiple reasons, you know?
Yeah.
But no, I don't, you know, I usually I'll do the seminars a couple hours before the show if I do them. So I'm kind of already, and I'm not really in wrestler mode yet, you know? So, but no, there's not a whole lot to it.
Is there any advice that seemed to always be the same thing you say quite constantly? Is it slow down? Is it like anything that, is there anything almost like a bugbear that you have where you see almost too often when you're watching some shows?
Slow down. What was I going to say? I had something when you asked me the question. I lost it. Connect with the audience. How do you stand out? This is what I always say to them. I go, even today for myself, when I go through that curtain, Billy, I tell myself in my mind, nobody out there knows who I am. You know, maybe some do, but there's probably people that are going to be there. Not probably. There will be somebody that's coming to a wrestling show for the very first time that night. Right. If there's 500 people out there, there's going to be at least one person who's seeing their first wrestling show. So they're not going to know me from the referee, you know, or any other guy. Right. So in my head, I always said, nobody knows who I am, but what am I going to do to make them remember me a month later? Again, back to those moments, right? Like, what can I do to give them a moment that they're going to remember? Or this is what I'll say. There's little Johnny. He's sitting in the front row. He's 10 years old. He was supposed to come with his cousin Jack, but Jack screwed up in school this week and his mother wouldn't let him come to the show. So how's 10-year-old Johnny, who does come to the show, going to go home and tell his cousin what he saw, right? So he's going to see 1,000 clotheslines, 1,000 hip tosses of, today we're going to see 400 Canadian destroyers, you know, dives, all this stuff that just kind of blends together. But what do you do? What are you going to give them for a moment that they remember you, right? Whether you're a good guy or a bad guy, you have to give them something. And it's not going to be your name. You got to remember, it's a live event. It's a live show. There's no commentators. So if you win, they'll hear your name when you're announced. Then you'll hear it when you, after the match, when you win the match. If you lose the match, they're only going to hear your name one time, and that's on your entrance, right? So they're not going to remember your name. You have to give them something else, you know? So I have all these little things, you know, I have a whole bag of things that I can reach into. Sometimes I'll plan to do it, sometimes I won't, you know, and sometimes I won't know what will work till I get out in front of that audience, you know? So it's, you know, and, you know, the big one, of course, for me is the worm, you know, and whether they know it from when I did it on television with WWE, or if they're coming to the show for the first time, they're still going to remember that, you know, with the WORM and the worm in, and it's a thing that they'll remember you by. But I'm also going to do a bunch of hip tosses, a clothesline over the top rope, you know, a bunch of moves that they're not going to remember that stuff. So I have to really think, like, what am I going to do? You know, a lot of times I'll pick a little boy up and I'll set him up on the apron and I'll do a pose down with him and something like that. Just, you know, especially you go to some of these small towns where there are a lot of little kids and a lot of families, like, how do you create some cool moments for them? You know,
that's it. We way back in that match 2014 in Grado, that again, that show itself, it's possibly one of my favorite shows of all time that I went to see live. And it was getting to see yourself and Grado as a match. But you mentioned that you picked up a child and you did the pose down. That was one of my like lasting memories for it. I think you came out and there was a little bit of a split crowd because it's Grado. So everyone loves Grado at the same time. And you just went to the crowd and picked up a child and kind of kidnapped him for a bit. And yeah, that's, and everyone was just like going, oh, this guy's all right. if it's the first time they've seen this Scotty character, they've went, yeah, he's good. We'll like him as well. We'll enjoy this.
Yeah, and the stuff with the kids, man, like they can feel that is genuine, you know, and it's not they you know, some of the people might know that kid, and you know, he's not a plant, he's not somebody's family member, he's a real live audience member who lives in the town, and you know, he's getting this really cool moment where, you know, where you put the spotlight on him for a minute, and it's awesome. It's a win-win for everybody, you know.
Absolutely. And so, speaking of this last run you had, of course, you did Iron Girders as well in Glasgow. That was you kind of interacted mostly with Leighton Buzzard. You had a match with him, and then you had a team. He seems to be doing phenomenal at the moment in around the world. He's in Canada, Europe, and what have you. So, is there anyone recently that you've wrestled with? I'm not saying Leighton as an example, but is there anyone you've been wrestling with recently? You think, oh, this guy should be. He should be somewhere. He should be out there more. Or it's just, yeah. Anyone in particular?
Yeah. Leighton's one of my go-to guys whenever anybody asks me this question. Leighton, LJ, Gene Money, Charles Crowley, you know, all these guys. Like, I think, you know, I don't know what's going on with that NXT Europe thing, if that's still a thing that's happening, but I see all of those guys getting picked up for that, you know, and especially the guy like Gene, who he is different. He does some different stuff. He does, you know, but he's a big guy, and I forget how big he is until I see him in person. And I think he really could do something, you know, if he wants to, and they want to do something with him. You know, it's just, it's, again, these guys are all, they're all putting in the work. Oh, dude. So I just hit me back to when you asked me what my advice, I always outwork everybody else. That's what I was going to say. Like, that's my big thing, is work harder than everybody else. And, you know, that's what those guys all do. They're, you know, you see Leighton, he's going to Canada and he's going to all these different countries. And, you know, that's not just happening by mistake. It's happening because he's making connections and he's making it happen. You know, it's kind of the same thing for me in 93 when I went to USWA in Memphis. Dude, I literally got my diploma at my high school, and I jumped on the highway, drove from the high school to the highway, and I drove to Tennessee to go to work for Lala, which is, I mean, I don't know if you know how far Tennessee is from where I grew up in Maine, but it's like, it's a 2-day drive. It's not like I just went 3 hours down the road. It's, you know, it's half a country away in the U.S., you know. But the same thing for those guys. Like, you see Charles is in Canada, working in Canada, and he's working in different places around the world. And you know, Gene's making an awesome name for himself. And you know, LJ's doing some stuff. And, you know, Session Moth Martina, she's out there killing it. You know, she's another one. She's got, like, you know, she's got this awesome energy about her, and she's fun to watch. And it's not just about wrestling. It's, she gets it, you know? You know, they're all going to do awesome things. You know, it's just being in the right place at the right time, you know, but you have to be prepared when that right time comes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, it's one of those things, the guys you mentioned and guys and girls you mentioned, there always seems to be a common denominator, though, that they all, not only that they have all that energy, but they always create moments, because Session Moth has the beer and all that kind of stuff. Gene, yeah, has this incredible, he was a guy that before the pandemic I would see on Discovery shows, because that's where he would wrestle in Scotland, and it was fine. He had good matches. There was nothing to excite nor offend, kind of thing. And then, right, something happened between the pandemic, and he came back and he was having matches with Big Damo and Andy Roberts, or Andy Wilde, however you want to know him. He had all these matches, and he was just a different kettle. He was just a different energy. He was a different cat. He was just on fire, and he's still got that Gene Money cheekiness, but yeah, he's got this extra edge to his work now, and it's definitely he's one of those guys who certainly, I didn't realize how good he was until after the pandemic came back, and he came back and was like, wow, this guy.
Yeah, and the fact that he's got some decent size to him is going to help him a lot too, you know. So, and I love them all those people I just mentioned. Like, I love them all, and I've, again, created some awesome relationships with these people over the last, you know, year and a half. People I didn't even know before then, you know, except for Session Moth Martina. I'd met her, I know, but I didn't really know her, you know. But I've got to hang out with these people, and so I love coming over there, man. It's like I've made these friends, you know, all the way back to the AWR days from Ireland, you know, when we were doing those shows before it was OTT. You know, it was kind of the same people running it, and it was called AWR, and we were doing, you know, lots of shows in Ireland and France and Germany and Switzerland and Bulgaria, Romania. And I mean, there's still people from that time frame that I stay in touch with, and just, it's awesome. You know, it's the greatest job in the world, man.
I just mentioned Discovery. That's kind of my last Scottish wrestling point. So I'll just get that in there. So you had your match with your team with Theodorus and Deacon Matthews against the Foundation of the Future. I'm absolutely not afraid to say that the Foundation of the Future are probably one of my favorite teams going right now, because they've got this kind of, they've got a bit of everything. They've got Big Bruiser Brad, and they've got Zach and Ryan. Just again, wrestling in Edinburgh, is that a different energy? Do you feel, between all the shows you've been to, so you've done Aberdeen, you've done Dumfries, you've done Glasgow, you've done Edinburgh, Do you feel a difference in crowds when you go to these shows, or do you feel that they're kind of all are kind of the same? They're all just up for wrestling.
They're all, to me, it's all kind of the same, but in a good way. Like, it's so different than here in the States. You know, I go sometimes when I go over there, it's just so hot every night. And I think people are just starting to around the world are getting to be exposed to that with WWE doing their, you know, they did the show in Wales, and then you know, I know in the crowd was just electric. And then, you know, I'm sure we'll see the same thing in London this weekend with the Money in the Bank pay-per-view, and then AEW is coming over there, you know, this summer. And it, people are getting to see, like, this is how a fun wrestling crowd reacts, you know? So a lot of times I'll come over there, and then I'll come back here and I'll do a show somewhere in the States. And it's just, people just sit there and they just, it's like, what's going on? Like, I did the same thing over, you know, in Scotland, and people are going crazy for it. And, but I don't know. It's magic. And it's honestly, man, I say all the time, like, if I could just wrestle in you know, the UK and that whole surrounding area, I would love to just, I've literally toyed with the idea of, like, I wonder what would happen if I moved over there for a few months and, you know, just try to base myself out of somewhere in the UK and, you know, would I wear on my welcome? Would it be too much? Would I overexpose myself? But again, I'm at a point in my life where, you know, the kids are adults now and everybody's kind of busy, and it'd be really cool to maybe try it sometime, just come over for a few months and see what I could do if I, you know, set up a base somewhere. But dude, I love coming over there. And it's just, but that night, you know, for Discovery, it's just, that's just, it's kind of how it is everywhere over there, at least from my perspective. It's just electric, and the fans just seem to appreciate it so much. And I don't think it's just me, you know, it's the whole show. It's so cool. It's such a cool environment, a cool atmosphere to be a part of. But then for me personally, I think from what I've been told, and like kind of going back to what you said earlier, that Royal Rumble, when I was at the peak of my career, was a lot of people's first exposure to WWE, you know. And then from what I understand, like the Sunday Night Heat and the Shotgun Saturday Night shows, which I was on a lot for a couple of years, got a lot of exposure over there. So maybe that lends to some of why it's so cool for me over there. I don't know, but I love it. Yeah.
I think it's because I don't know what the scene is like in the US, but it seems to be that over here anyway, wrestling's a luxury, because there's always, everywhere's got this cost of living crisis and what have you, but wrestling's a luxury. So if you're putting down £15 per ticket, you're going to enjoy yourself, because if you don't, you've wasted £15. You have to enjoy yourself in that period, because you've paid for it. I don't know if it's just because we're Scottish and we're quite stereotypically tight with money, so it's like, no, we've paid our money, I'm staying here till the end, and I'm going to enjoy myself whether I like whether I want to or not, kind of thing. But I was here UK crowds as well. I mean, you said Wales and Puerto Rico as well. Amazing show.
Yeah, it's crazy, right?
It's just, it goes to show, I don't know the US scene, but it seems to be that the US crowds are, I don't know, they expect something. And whereas outside of that, they're just excited that they're getting to see WWE.
It might be, I don't know, like if they expect it, or if it's just maybe a sense of burnout. You know, maybe it's just been so much, and they know there's so many shows going on over here, and just like, I don't know. It's hard to explain, or it's just a different culture. I don't know, you know, but I do love coming over there.
So we did get a question through our Patreon. I didn't want to put it on social media, because I'm one of those, if I'm getting a guest that I really want on, I don't want to jinx it by putting it out that I've got you on the show. So I went to our Patreon and got a question in from Bronze Cello. Thank you very much for sending it in. He's got a little bit of a bit before it. He's been lucky to catch you in a few tours over the years at shows here in the UK, most recently at Discovery in Edinburgh. He met you that night and thanks you for being a class act. His questions are, what's some of your favorite UK memories?
Oh, man. I think probably some of the first come to mind just over the last year and a half is last July. I think I was there for 3 weeks, and I brought my son with me, and we had some down, you know, some downtime. And he was actually at the North Show with me. And he was on that whole tour. But we went to Wales and we stayed in Tenby, Wales for a few days. And just, I don't know, man. I grew up in a small town in Maine, and I was just, all I ever wanted to be was a pro wrestler. You know, I never had any other desires, or, you know, I had no idea that I was going to be able to wrestle outside of my town, you know, outside of my state, let alone outside of the country. And I'd go to places where, you know, people are like genuinely excited to meet you and say hello. And so it's just, it's hard to put into words, man, but it's really been cool. I know I already said it, but like over the last year and a half, just to experience that and have my kids old enough to where they can be a part of it and I can bring them, you know, and, I don't know, like going back to those AWR tours was the real memories I have are from those AWR tours. You know, we were doing Ireland and France and stuff with that. It was, you know, it was a bunch of young Irish guys, you know, and, you know, Sean Brennan and Paddy Morrow and those guys who are, you know, a huge part of OTT now. And you know, Joe Cabray, who runs OTT, and Jamie Coleman, who's the announcer and the commentator. And all those guys were a part of that. And I still talk to all of those guys, you know, quite frequently, actually, you know, and I don't know. There's just something cool about that to me. Like I have these friends over there and I've made all these friends through wrestling, and there's not so much wrestling memories that I have. It's just, you know, hanging out with those guys or being on a tour bus with those guys and, or now coming over there with my son and going to the different, it's hard for me not to say soccer. I know like all your listeners are going to, you know, going to lynch me for saying soccer, but it's, you know, my son plays soccer here and he's a huge fan. So we go to the, you know, this, when we were over there last July, we went to a bunch of different football stadiums, you know, we went to Manchester and Liverpool and went to a game in Glasgow and with Wolfgang. So all those are the real memories, you know, where I think the shows sometimes tend to blend together, you know, but the shows blend together. So I go back like talking about moments, right? Like I don't have any idea what I did in this match, but I remember the crowd was a lot of fun, you know, and you literally like remember certain people you meet or like moments that, you know, for me, it's like fans are creating moments for me, I guess, you know, so yeah. But not really wrestling moments or wrestling memories, you know, it's more about, you know, being a tourist and getting to go to these places. Like I said, growing up in a small town in Maine, I had no idea I'd be able to spend, you know, I was in London taking a tour of Parliament the day that the Prime Minister resigned, right? I was literally in there, you know, so it's like, I got blamed for it all, you know? But it's like, it's just crazy life I've got to lead, you know?
No, what the scary thing about that last bit, though, if it was last year, I could sit here and go, which one?
Yeah, it was last year, so it would have been July, you know?
Yeah. There was that many last year that seemed to resign.
A
wild one. Rochelle has also added, what's your favorite UK food? Have you got any haunts you want to try and get to when you're in the UK?
Oh man. So I put a post on social media of me in front of the Nando sign, and some people like they thought it was awesome. Like, I don't know, I think it's an American thing where we just love Nando's because we don't really have there's a few here and there, but not like over there, man, where it's like every other block it seems like you can find a Nando's, right? So I really love the Nando's. But people are just some of them like crucified me on social media for like Nando's. And I'm like, man, like, I don't know.
I think if we've learned anything in the last year or so, that social media is terrible and that's a horrible.
Oh, it's awful. Yeah. Awful. It's just, well, I have such a love hate relationship with it because I just said this to somebody last night. I think social media would be so much more of a better place if everybody was legitimately verified with their real names and a real profile picture. It's so easy for people to gun other people down with no profile picture or under a fake name, you know, where you would still have, you know, negativity on there, I think, but I don't think it would be as bad if everybody was legitimately verified. you know. Absolutely. And I don't mean verified by a blue check. I mean, like, if you want to be on Twitter, if you want to be on Facebook or Instagram, like, you have to submit a pit just like a driver's license. You know, you have a picture and it stays the same. And I just think it'd be a better place, you know, because it can be such a great thing, dude. Like, it could be such a great thing. All those guys I talked to you about like AWR, that's how I've stayed in touch with them is, you know, through social media. And I've watched, you know, them have kids and their kids grow up and, you know, them just go through stuff in their lives through social media, and you feel like you see them all the time, but you really don't. Sometimes it's years you go without seeing people, but you feel like you see them because of social media. So it can be such a good thing. It's just, you know, a large part of it, especially in the with the wrestling culture, it just becomes kind of this cesspool of hate, you know, and I wish it would just go away, you know.
I absolutely agree with you, and I'm quite an antisocial person. I'm not a person that'll come up to people after shows and what have you. And I'm up in the northeast of Scotland, so I don't get down to Glasgow and stuff like that. It's too far, or trains are too expensive. So this has been the way for me to do this podcast and approach wrestlers like yourself and like the other people that I've had on in the past 200 odd episodes. It's that, in that respect, it's good, and I get to keep it up to date and all that stuff. But I don't know. I think I'm just very lucky with my algorithm. I don't see a lot of the negativity. I seem to be very lucky, but I know it's a terrible, horrible place. But, you know, we're here for positivity, and that's what we're
going to continue. So back to just before, I know we touched on iron girders a little bit, but I just wanted to make sure I talk about them a little bit. But, dude, like, I worked with Wolfgang a little bit when he was at NXT and I was coaching there, and as you know, I'd always heard his name around from different mutual friends we had, and never really knew him until after I left. And I went over there and I worked for him at Iron Girders a couple times, and with him and his wife, and just, he's such a good dude, man. Like, he's such a genuine good person. And he's got such a, I would love to do what he has in Glasgow, where he just has a small building with a ring, and he's got a gym in there, and he does classes in there, and the ring stays up, and you know, these people come in and they're able to train, but he's also able to do these small shows right in house. It's such a cool thing, and I would love to do something like that here, where it could give some young people a chance to not only, you know, work and train during the week, but also do shows once a month right in the same place that they're comfortable with. And, you know, it's a small crowd, which is okay. There's nothing wrong with a small crowd, because that's kind of how you can learn and not be overexposed. And, you know, if you go out in front of, you know, a couple thousand people when you first start wrestling and you get overexposed, that can be a bad thing, you know, whereas if it's just a, you know, 100, 200 people, it's great. You get to try stuff, see what works, what doesn't. And he's got such a cool thing going on there. And he's been so cool to me and to my son and stuff. So good dude, man. Good dude.
Absolutely. And it's one of those promotions where I'm seeing the names come out there. There's a lot of really, like, really polished guys that I've seen come out. And not only in wrestling aspect, which is a very important thing, but also their social media and their actual online presence. Which for me, being up in the north, being so far north in Scotland, that's how I see a lot of these wrestlers, is through their social engagement and seeing guys like, I'll just give a couple of them a shout out. We've seen Leighton, of course, but guys like the Casino Brutal guys, Mikey Devine and Robbie Romero, they're doing all these cool online skits and stuff where they're doing gambling. So one of them tried to gamble their name away in a match and stuff like that. It's just, that's when you're, it's all good, well and good being a good wrestler, but if you're able to exude your character on, that's when social media is good. You can exude your character online, so people go, "Oh, I saw that guy on Twitter. Oh, they've got a show coming up. I'll go to that show and see them." So yeah, Iron Girders seem to be doing a lot of good.
I actually spend a good part of my seminars talking about using social media to your benefit, and, like, you know, be smart with it, and, you know, like, build your character and try stuff and shoot videos and see what works, and, you know, build a name. And then, you know, once you feel like you've got something solid, you know, you can start tagging all the promotions or wrestling companies in the UK. You know, if you're in the UK, you just start tagging everybody and hashtagging everybody, and, you know, you get seen. But, you know, you don't want to do that until you feel like you have something that's good, you know, because, again, you don't want to overexpose yourself, right? So there's a lot of people that just don't use it the right way, and they don't build their brand with it. And it just seems like it's a free tool that you can use. And I'm older, you know, and you know, I'm older than most of these people. Like, you know, so, and I can figure out how to use iMovie or whatever to edit my own stuff. And I do, you know, I just put a video out today and, you know, and just to kind of, you know, if we could sell some more tickets or build some more anticipation, build some excitement that I'm coming over there, like whatever I can do, it's all free, you know? So, a big pet peeve of mine is you see a lot of these cell phone videos, you know, a lot of promoters go, hey, can you, and they'll ask me, hey, can you do a cell phone video for saying that you're coming to blah, blah, blah. And I'll be like, no, I don't do those. Like, just because for me, it feels like, you know, the fan wants to see what they know me as, you know, and if I'm just doing a cell phone video, it's kind of like right now I'm talking to you as Scott Garland and like, not the wrestler, it's just the person. Right. So, but if I'm promoting an event that I'm going to be at, you know, I don't want to be sitting in my house, you know, with my couch in the background and just me holding the video going, hey, I'm coming. To me, it just feels like it's kind of amateur, you know? So I would rather put together, take some time and put together a video saying that I'm coming to Plymouth or wherever I'm coming to, like, you know, and put some cool music behind it, some cool, you know, some cool video and build the excitement that way rather than just a cell phone video that anybody can do. You know, you want to look like a star, I think, mm-hmm. You know, that's what I'm trying to say.
That's I get that, because Scotty Hotty as a character wasn't known for getting on the microphone and he was all right. About the little facials and subtleties and obviously right. the worm and the dance.
Part of the problem was my partner talked so much, it was hard for me to get a word in edgewise. That's what I was always joking about. And he was so good at talking and I wasn't very good. So, yeah.
But people are going to go, oh, it's quite hot. He's got a 2-minute promo. But
Yeah,
I absolutely understand that.
No, and nobody wants to watch a 2-minute. That's the thing with this social media. Like, I'll keep my videos. The longest I'll do is a minute most of the time. You know, sometimes I'll shoot for 30 seconds. You can get everything in 30 seconds. You know, the place, the building, the date, who it is, and you know, because you know how it is. You just scroll on through it's Instagram, and you gotta make it quick. You know, hopefully you can grab their attention and get them to watch it. But nobody's watching a 2-minute video, right? Yeah.
But hopefully we're watching this hour-long podcast.
I think podcasts are different, you know. Mm-hmm. What, Cornette did like 5 hours last week, I think, you know. And Joe Rogan will do 3 to 5 hours sometimes, you know, 3, 4, 5 hours. It's like, and it's entertaining. So, you know, as long as you know what you're in for, though. You know, with a podcast, you know, okay, it's going to be an hour, whatever it's going to be, you know, whereas if you're just scrolling through social media, it's a different story. Yeah. You know, you're not sitting down to listen or you're driving to work or whatever, you know.
Absolutely. But this is because you mentioned Brian Christopher, Grandmaster Sexy. I'm just going to just put this story in there because it always makes me laugh. My mom doesn't know that many wrestlers. And the one that she always knew for some reason was when I used to watch SmackDown in my living room in my first home, and she would always ask about Grandmaster Sexy because it was the name that always stuck in her head, and it just always tickles me that if I was speaking about wrestling, she'd be like, oh, I used to like that Grandmaster Sexy, and always with the A. She'd always pronounce it with A in there as well. I don't know if there's any stories you can share that you haven't already, but is there any particular memories you have just as too cool, whether on the road or just at a show that just kind of summed up either the trio or Brian in particular?
No, it's funny, man, because like we weren't the best of friends. We weren't close at all. I mean, I would even go as far to say like we kind of didn't like each other at times. Not that we didn't like each other, we were just so different. We were so different as people, I think. And we didn't room together, we didn't ride together. We would basically we'd see each other at the building and we'd go through the curtain, and when we went through that curtain, it was magic. That's what was that was the crazy part about it, you know. It was like people thought we were best friends, and like I said, it's not that we hated each other, not that we didn't like each other, just we were just totally different people. We really had nothing in common, you know. I was a theme park nerd, he was a football nerd, you know, and American football nerd, you know. Until I, you know, I say this and I'm thankful for this, like in the last couple of years of his life, we started to get a little bit closer, you know. And I'm glad that happened, you know, because we went, I think, 5 years without even speaking. We had a bit of a falling out. And then we cleared everything up. In the last couple of years, like, we would just kind of go back and forth through text sometimes, and just like the last text that I actually have from him is him. He sent me a picture of his son, who was wrestling, high school wrestling, school wrestling at the time. So that was kind of cool, that was the last thing I ever got from him, was him talking about his son, because he wasn't super close with his son for most of his life. So it was kind of cool that that was the last thing. But now there's not a lot of, so like I said, outside of what you saw on TV, there wasn't a lot of interaction between us. It was just, we were kind of thrown together at the Battle Royal at WrestleMania 14 for whatever reason. I still don't know why the two of us were put together in that Battle Royal. Like, it made no sense at all if you look back, because I was a babyface, he was a heel, and here you have, all of these, you had the Road Warriors, and you had it was Bob and Billy, Bob Holly and Billy, like all these guys that were real tag teams at the time, and then you had Brian Christopher and Scott Taylor thrown in there for what. And dude, I had been sitting home at that point, like not doing anything, just really preparing for the phone call to get released from the company. And I got a phone call one Wednesday afternoon saying that I was going to be a part of WrestleMania, and it made no sense. But for whatever reason, it just, everything fell into place, and that's back to what I said earlier about like outworking everybody and working hard, and just be ready for that moment when things align and then things happen, so weird, man.
Yeah. Just stars aligned before, I don't want to keep you on far too much longer, because you've got a whole day and I've got a whole night to go. Did you ever realize how bad luck you've had in battle royals in the past? Because I'm going through just watching some old wrestling clips, and of course Royal Rumble 2001 be one of my favorites of all time. You didn't make it. Oh, no, you did make it in, but it was against the Brothers of Destruction. And then I think it was later that year you had the Invasion, the one at Survivor Series, where you didn't actually make it in. Did you ever sit and just go, was Battle Royal something you enjoyed doing, or are you quite glad that you didn't have to do them? just you never notice one of those things?
Yeah, so where people will say that you were so unlucky, but then, dude, you think about this, like, I could have had a match that night, right? And I could have had a singles match on that same show, right? On the Royal Rumble show. So they had a single match with D'Lo Brown, right? So I had a match with D'Lo Brown. I go out there, I do my thing, hit the worm, cover him, 1, 2, 3. We wouldn't be having this conversation right now. Mm-hmm. But again, back to the moments. I had these moments on these shows that I didn't even realize at the time how cool they were. You got to think that thing with Taker and Kane, where it came out, and it's just the two of them. Like, dude, that's something every year at Royal Rumble, people start tagging me in those posts with that, or, with Taker getting eliminated by Maven. And then here I come again. And, dude, I'm talking about moments with The Undertaker, like one of the biggest names of all time that we're talking about 20 years later, whereas if it was just a singles match where I did everything, dominated the match, and then beat him with a worm, nobody would be remembered. Nobody would be talking about that now, So, and, I didn't know about moments then even, So I'm just, when I talk to you about moments now, I'm just, or in my seminars, I'm talking about stuff that I've learned over the years, and it might be only within the last few years, like this stuff has kind of clicked with me, where it's like, it's about moments. People remember the moments, you think about Hogan and Rock at WrestleMania in Toronto. Nobody remembers anything that they did in the match. They remember the stare off, mm-hmm. where people chanted the dueling chants with Hogan and Rock, and whatever they were saying. And, like, that's what you remember from the Hogan Rock match, is the cool moments, So, no, but it's like, had some, really cool Royal Rumble moments that, for a guy like Undertaker, who I never got to wrestle, to have those with him and not even realize that, like, when it happened until, 2 decades later, how cool it was,
I mean, you mentioned those, like the dance off in 2000, that always appears in the big breakdown things that each year.
Crazy.
So
Yeah, well, people ask me, like, what's my favorite match or what's my biggest match or whatever. And I mean, I can't even go to a match. You got to think, like, that's the moment that put us on the map, was that Royal Rumble dance in 2000. It was just, again, the stars aligned, man. It was the Royal Rumble. It was New York City. It was sold out. It was the peak of that time. Everything was so hot. And, you know, it was just, it was so different at the time, you know, for us to break into this dance. And it was just, it was like, we were just right there. And that just, that kind of put us on the map, you know. And it was the crazy part about that, dude, is like, I didn't even realize this until the last year or so, was that the Royal Rumble is in January, right?
Mm-hmm.
Too Cool and Rikishi didn't come, it wasn't a thing until a month before. So we were only together for a month when we got to that Royal Rumble and we did that dance. That's how fast things can happen. You know, we went from almost being unemployed, I think, you know, and in the fall to, you know, Brian and I came back in at the end of October, I think. We did a little bit on our own. And then December, Rikishi joined us. And then January, 30 days later, basically, we're doing that dance and the place is going crazy at the Royal Rumble. It's just insane.
If you look back at the year 2000, and year 2000 in general, but yours especially, because you had the dance. You were tag champions, I think, during 2000 as well. And you won the light heavyweight title in 2000. And you had... people are now, I think people are now starting to wake up, because it was only last year or so that people are going back to see your match with Dean Malenko going, these matches were phenomenal. kind of thing. So that whole year, and that was the year I started proper getting into WWF. I think I came in at the right time to see, like you say, you were saying that was you at your peak, the peak of the industry as well. And it was just, again, stars aligning. That's, I got in the year 2000. Here we are 23 years later. Speaking about it.
Yeah. And like, that was another thing I don't think I realized how important it was to my career at the time, was working with Dean and Eddie and the Radicals and Chris and Perry. You know, you had four guys who didn't do any showbiz at the time. They were wrestlers. They were wrestlers from WCW who were great wrestlers. You know, they were all great before they got to WCW, you know. And now you take this guy who dances and does the worm, and you put him in there with Dean Malenko, who doesn't even smile, and he's a man of a thousand holds. Like, that's what made me, I think, you know, was working with Dean, because it was so polar opposite that everything that I did should bug him, because he's the serious guy and I'm the clown over here just having fun, you know. So, and that's what makes everything work. And I think, you know, in wrestling in general, that's what's so cool, is if you take a guy who's 6'8" and then you put him against Rey Mysterio, who's 5 feet tall, and, you know, what's going to happen? Like, and I think that's kind of what we've lost in the last few years, is everybody's just kind of the same.
Yeah.
You know, it's, you know, I'll say in my seminars, whether it's, you go back to, you know, if you go back to Gorgeous George, who I've never seen wrestle a match, but I know who he is because of his outlandish characters. And then you go to the Hogan, if you go to the Hogan era in the 80s, you know, and you had Bossman and DiBiase and Jake and Coco and Rick Martel and the Model and, you know, all of these outlandish characters. Not that they're outlandish, but they just stuck out so much. You got, if you're flipping to the channels, you go, I need to watch this guy with a bird on his shoulder. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, this guy putting a python on somebody, like, and then you skip, you know, fast forward to the Attitude Era again, you had all these crazy characters, you know. And to me, like, it's kind of weird to me that, like, we've pulled the curtain all the way back and we go, okay, it's all predetermined, it's a show, it's not a real competition, but now it seems to be more about the wrestling than ever. Like, how does that, like, we said it's a show, but now we're going to be serious, is the most serious we've ever been. So it's a bit weird, but that's back to what I was saying though. Like, that's just the characters are what makes it for me and always made it fun, you know?
Absolutely. So you said you're going to do, you had those moments in Rumbles and Battle Royals and that, and you made the moments without having to actually take too much of the damage as well. So I'm assuming you never really, when anyone suggested TLC matches with Hardys and that, you were quite happy just to go, no, that's their moment. You keep that moment. That's
fine.
Right. So before we go, I'm going to plug your upcoming tour. We asked two questions to all of our guests. They're not wrestling related. They're just ridiculous, stupid questions, really. But you might enjoy them. The first one we ask people is, what's your... hit this mic so many times. The first question we ask everyone is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Favorite dinosaur? Man.
very aware that I've asked a wrestler that I've been a fan of for over 20 years a stupid question, but I'm still here for it.
Man, I don't know. I think I'd have to go with a Stegosaurus Rex.
Good choice, which is weird because that's what I've got tattooed on me.
There you go, right?
There you go. Stars align. Another question we ask everyone.
I don't know, was it even a Stegosaurus Rex or just a Stegosaurus?
I think it's just a Stegosaurus, unless there's some hybrid somewhere.
That's what it was. There were like two or three they found in like Nevada, I think. There was a guy called the Stegosaurus Rex.
Right, so it's not that. That's
I'm more
excited about finding it. But I knew enough when I was young about dinosaurs, and since I've started this podcast, it seems to be the question I ask everyone. I'm learning more about dinosaurs as I go along. The other question we ask people is another thinker. It's what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow? This is the one that you're going to ask people the rest of the day because it's going to just bug and it's going to stay in your mind.
I think I go with the two sheep.
Good answer. That's my pick.
Yeah, because there's two of them and they're faster. The cows don't seem to care about anything except for eating, you know?
That's it. I'm not going to argue with you because that's always been my pick. It's always been the sheep. And I've got people coming in here that you butchers and they pick cows. It's a sheep every time. Anyway, so we'll keep you too much longer. We'll go through. I'll plug your tour and then I'll let you go for the rest of the day. So you are back in England and France for July. We've got 7th in Crawley, England for the time to say England. Oh, that's the Scottishism in me. 7th of July in Crawley, England for Capau. You're in 8th in Béziers. Hope I say that right. In France for Catch, Darlaston, England, 14th for Pro Wrestling Live, 15th in Newcastle for North, 16th for Future Shock in Manchester, and Reach Wrestling on the 22nd in Plymouth. And then you're back again in November as well for...
I just started to put together the November stuff. So maybe it may even be like as early as late October through the end of November, maybe. This could be a long one. Wait, let's look in right now. So again, I'm just like trying not to burn myself out over there, you know, but I love coming over so much. So if I have the opportunity to come, it's hard to say no, you know. Especially even like Malta, you know, done a little bit, did a training seminar in Malta, and we're trying to put together some stuff where I come over, maybe do a show for them. And such a cool opportunity, like get to wrestle in Malta, man. Like, how do you say no to that, you know?
Exactly. You've got to make hay while the sun shines. I think that's the phrase. But perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. I'm so glad that we were able to finally get this organized. And I've exhausted all of my notes here. And we could sit here and speak about more Disneyland stuff. But I'm very conscious that I don't want to burn out our chat here. Maybe we'll do something in the future. But hopefully you're up my neck of the woods again for WrestleZone or something. I'll get to meet you in person one more time. Hopefully I'll be a little bit thinner than I am now. But no, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me. I don't know if
thanks,
you want
to. Good talking to you. It was fun talk, man. Thank you. I do appreciate it.
Man, do you want to plug your social media or are you just happy to just go, you know who I am?
No, I mean, everything is under my real name now. It's, the Scott Garland on Twitter and on Instagram. Facebook is still Scotty Too Hotty. WWE is supposed to change it, but they haven't yet. So, but that's, you know, that's it. Everything's kind of intertwined and connected. So, it's pretty easy to find.
Excellent. Well, perfect. Well, thanks again.
Yeah. Thank you, man.